at the American Courage Association Convention, and we're glad to have her back. She's a graduate of North Carolina State with a degree in animal science and has a lifelong love of horses. Mrs. Paulson's dissected and photo-documented countless equine limbs with the intent of expanding hoof care professionals' understanding. And we're very happy to have you back. I mean that sincerely. Maybe happy back again next year. We'll see how you do, though.
Being judged, you gotta be kind.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, Paige Paulson.
So, this is not my favorite way to do dissections, because I really like people to be able to touch things, little things, and learn and feel the mechanics themselves. So, I put together a PowerPoint to help guide you through it, since you can't get up here and I can't share like I normally would. So, I'm going to start with PowerPoint, and then I've got these legs prepped. I took two distinctly different feet so that you can see the differences of different problems that you might be dealing with. I'll get rolling better in a few minutes. I always start out a little slow. So, this is, we're going to look at the back of the foot. I do wish that I could do a sagittal cut and we could really look at things this way, but I thought that was an awesome picture to show you a lot of the details at the back of the foot. So I started doing legs because I really wanted to understand the mechanics. And my neighbors were really excited with my job. Anytime I went to get legs, they were like, is there any for me? And then when I bought that house, it was so funny because I was so nervous. My shop was right near another house. Like, I lived in the country, but of course the shop was right there. Was a veterinary pathologist. How sweet was that? So, what I wanted to cover today is looking at some of the different structures at the back of the foot and how they're all integrated together, and hoping you can understand some of the mechanics that you might not realize you're dealing with, like how the collateral cartilages work and the digital cushion, how nerves really haunt you, and showing you some pictures of a nerve dissection that I did has really helped me with some problematic horses. And then we're going to go down and look at the navicular region. So what I wanted to start with is I just really like this, looking at the lateral cartilages. So I've pulled the hoof capsule on this foot and shown you the peak of the lateral cartilage. I don't understand. Can I get a pointer without a highlighter? Or is that not possible? Anyway, if I could just get the arrow, I'd be happy. You know what? I have a laser pointer. That might be easier. Hold on. So this is your lateral cartilage, and look at, this is the coronary band, and on the next slide, I started peeling off the cushion, or the coronary band, coronary cushion, and then I continued down, and this is what I got at the end, and it was really fascinating to me to see that the coronary band is not on bone at all, none of it. It's on soft tissue, and it appears that it is attached with fascia, just like in other parts of the body. Well, if you think about how brilliant that is, that's what gives this capsule a little bit of movement. And if you, and that is wonderful. It can be a problem for us and our job, but it is wonderful because any imbalance, the horse can actually adjust somewhat for imbalances. But, so you've got all this soft tissue here, and the only bony attachment is in this part of the foot. So your front part of the coffin bone and at the sole. Everything else has more movement to it. same dissection, man, I really ran this one through the wringer. So then I took out the, I took out P2 so that you could see, you could actually see the lateral cartilage, and the little missing void is where the bone is and the ligament that normally attaches P2. But then here, I have shown you the inside portion of, and if you look carefully, that is where the deep digital is attaching, or what appears to be where the deep digital is attaching, right here. Your navicular would be right in here, so this is probably part of the bursa. But what I wanted you to see is that those lateral cartilages are literally a slab of lateral cartilage. And it comes off the end of the coffin bone, the back of the coffin bone. You have a piece of cartilage similar to that in your nose. And they vary in size. Some horses have thicker cartilages than others. So I continued on, and I took my blade, and I carefully removed the lateral cartilage from the coffin bone. And it just, like taking piece by piece apart so that I can figure out where's my placement and understand the back of the foot like this. And it's surprising that, again, the whole heel bulb is cartilage. All of that is cartilage. So this is kind of my own terminology. I either call this the true heel or the anatomical heel. Depends on how lazy I am. It's a little easier to say. And that is where the end of the sole corium is. You've got, this is like the seat of the horn, the internal seat of the horn. And all of these tissues are growing what we work with. What we see. So this lamina is growing in the part of the bar, the lamina wrapping around here, and then you've got your wall growing down from the coronary band. So that, remember that sheet of cartilage we were looking at? If you follow this back, look at, there's a point there and then your heel bulb. This end of the lamina here to the end of the variopal at your heel bulb varies in distance. So this is what I would call the true heel on this one. But I've taken all the lamina and stuff off. This picture may help you understand that peak I was talking about better. Technical difficulties. So again, this is that sheet of cartilage, then it's going to wrap down and you've got your heel bulb. These papillae are growing the outer portion of the bar, and then it wraps around and starts growing the hook wall. Here are your sole papillae and the lamina. So I think of those lateral cartilages, or collateral cartilages, almost as a box or a container. And your digital cushion is going to fit in between those two cartilages. So the shape of your cartilage is going to kind of determine where the packing is in this box. And on a more upright heel, your package material is going to be up close and close to the bony column. And here, this is what a friend of mine refers to, this type of heel configuration, as a baboon's ass. Simon, do you know who says that? Declan. Oh. And right here, that's the baboon's ass. But look at the difference. So this is that hoof, And look at the different configuration of your lateral cartilage and your heel bone. Can you see, this one still kind of protrudes out a little bit more. Some of them are even shorter. But can you see the different shapes? Now, this, look at that true heel versus here, and look at the pitch right there. You can almost see that as your heel grows in, it's got a ledge to sit on. That's adding some strength to it. Here, if you keep waiting, if you pull your heel back too much, what are you actually waiting? You're the cartilage, yeah. And you start in, I have a theory, and I don't take my theories too seriously, so I'll just throw it out there, but I feel like the pressure of going up this way starts making that angle shallower. And even your periopal that gets wider as it comes around the heel bowl, all the pressure of those tissues starts getting jacked and actually keep pulling everything out and flattening all the way up. The whole heel area starts rocking backwards, and this pull this way is causing that periopal and everything to thin and put excess pressure on this cartilage. Because we all, Pat said it earlier, he doesn't see this that much on the young horses that he's working on. This seems to accumulate over time. And it would be interesting to see if it's just that incremental pressure, just day in and day out, the pressure on the lateral cartilage, the back of the foot is loaded too much. But is it the fascia? Is it the periopal? Is it the other tissues also adding to the pressure there? I sit in my own little shop by myself a little too much, so harebrained ideas. But it's worth putting out there and just seeing. You know, I don't mind being called crazy, but there might be more pressures going on than we think about. So here's that box. If I took the same, say they have the same volume, if I tap this one, and I can maybe even stand on it, and it would support my weight. But the longer, thinner one, packed with the same material, would be weaker if I tried to stand on it. So if you go back, you have to imagine the cushion is helping support those cartilages and vice versa, along with the wall. And here you've got that long skinny box and all of your contents are being pulled outward.
Okay, this is just a random question, but the feet in the photo, like that white coronary band foot is not the foot in that photo, correct?
This foot is that dissection. And this foot is that dissection. Look at the prolapsed frog.
Right.
And yes, that is the feet.
Oh, just because he doesn't have any white hair.
Well, because, oh, you know why? The other side doesn't have it.
Okay.
And I forgot that I had those mixed up on there, but it is the same foot.
Okay.
But you're right.
I just was like, okay, I just want to be sure I'm seeing.
This is the lateral side.
Okay.
That is a picture of the medial side, because I didn't take the, dissect out the cartilage on both sides.
Okay,
but it is the same foot.
Okay.
And what's cool is I'll bring my computer to my booth, and if anybody wants to look at more of these images, I'm happy to pull them out and have you explore more if you like.
Cool. What's your
booth? Anatomy of the Equine. It's over there. I'll be there all day tomorrow and the next day. So again, that's one analogy I think of with the lateral cartilages. The other is if you, again, think of cardboard, and you've got either both of these cartilages extending out behind the coffin bone. Think about cardboard. If you sit it perpendicular to the ground and weight it, it's relatively strong. The thicker it is, the stronger it is. But the minute you start pitching it, you either weigh it too far back, like a negative Palmer, or you start getting a, what I call as a wing on my heels, where they start extending out, you're now loading this cartilage in various ways that's not helping it stay strong. So that's my other cardboard analogy. Now into the digital cushion. Okay, that's, I cut this foot and I cut it crooked. So you saw the peak of the lateral cartilage. I hit the peak on this one, but I came a little too far forward on that one. So that's why they look so different. This was actually a really healthy looking foot. But what's the most interesting to me is, do you see all these little striations, these little ligaments running from side to side? That is this web of part of little ligaments that end up supporting and helping support from cartilage to cartilage. Not all feet have many of these. And then you've got the integrity of this is a fibrous fatty tissue, similar to what you have in the palm of your hand and on your feet. And some forces have a more robust and more than others. And I don't know, I heard somebody ask had a question about digital cushioning coming back. And I just don't know. But can you see how having more healthy tissue in here is helping to support your lateral cartilage? This is that same horse that we saw earlier. That's the one that I showed you the white side of his foot. This was his high foot and this was his low foot. So again, I'm trying to kind of show the difference from the end of where the lamina, or right where the lamina start. Actually, when you see it on the screen this big, I missed the mark. But anyway, it's just a way of looking at him. And this is the spine of his frog, and that is the spine of his frog on his underarm. And, you know, I take these things apart, and I take anywhere from 800 to 1,200 pictures per foot I take apart. I spend hours, and like such a geek. And for some reason, I did not get a cut like this on this side of the foot. But you can tell from the tubules the different pitch, and I am following the tubules there. And if I had cut this one, I would have cut it right there. Look at the difference in the pitch. But that pitch is, look at the difference in this pitch versus that pitch. I have another pseudo theory, and I really don't know if this one's true, but it's something that has helped me when I'm kind of assessing low heel horses. The more of these feet I take apart, that true heel seems to roughly fall in line with the peak of my lateral cartilage. And that kind of helps me not pull the foot back too far. And you can come back further than that. And I'm not talking about short shoeing. You have to remember, I'm a barefoot trimmer, so I don't have the mechanism. I'm always subtracting from a foot, unless I'm just adding, you know, cast or digital, I mean, dental impression material or something like that. So I don't have the mechanics. I don't have the issues that you guys do. You guys are adding to it, so I can't really speak with authority on some of this heel stuff. But that has helped me realize that I need to be patient and not keep coming back too hard, because I don't want to be loading this heel bolt inappropriately. So that's why I was looking for a marker to help me realize that I don't want to keep bringing my heels back too aggressively. Sorry, I'm rambling. Tom said, I'm prattling. All right, this is one other important dissection that I did, that this is medial palmar nerve. And it it's coming down, and here's the peak of my lateral carpal vision. Do you see how that guy is coming in right near the peak? This is your nerve. And it branches out. I just need to keep this along. It had new batteries, so it's just getting old and sad. All right, did anybody see that nerve? What I've done there is I've started cutting the lateral cartilage, peeling it away. And here, I've gone through the middle of the lateral cartilage. And look at those tendrils of what appears to be nerve right here. So this is the major trunk of the nerve, and then there is these little tendrils, like I said. So does this explain why some of these horses are so heel sore? If you've got the peak of that lateral cartilage, I had two navicular horses that came to me at the same time, and both of them had been getting good care, but the people were desperate, so of course the farrier was the problem, and they called me. And I remember they were owned by different people and different horses. And I remember telling the owners that I'm not sure I'm going to make any difference because I'm not going to do anything that different than what the previous person had done. But they both got better almost immediately. I just did my trim and didn't expect much. And one of them had been retired for 3 years. She had not been rideable. She had all kinds of diagnostics. And they said she had navicular syndrome. The woman just wanted the horse more comfortable. Well, it's 9 years later, and she's still riding the horse. The only thing I could figure is that there was some nerve impingement up near the top of the lateral cartilage, and that something with the way that I addressed the foot changed that. Now, at the end of a trimming cycle, as her toes seemed to get a little longer, she would often go back to being a little bit off when we get her trimmed. So then the woman moved to another state, and within the first trim, the horse went unsound again. And she was not sound for 6 months, the whole 6 months they lived down there. They moved back, and I trimmed her, and she came back. Now, that is not a true navicular horse, and that is not typical. But I had this other horse that kind of came to me at the same time, and the same type of thing happened. And the reason I think it might be nerve impingement is I cannot wear a watch with a metal wristband, or leather, any other kind of strap, but I have a nerve right here. And when that gets hit, it hurts like an oboe. And so I just wonder if we can occasionally have nerve impingement there. Yes?
How are you trimming the heels on that horse?
Actually, I was leaving a little more heel and I was really bringing my toes back. But I don't remember anything stellar about what I was doing, other than just pulling my toes back a little more and letting them have a little more heel. So they weren't sitting as hard back on the heels. I don't know. That's not a good answer, is it?
Yeah, it is.
All right, I'm going to keep this on. So then I continued on with my dissection, and this is that nerve. That picture is really fuzzy. I thought it was a good one. So, but this nerve has wrapped down underneath, and the only thing between it and the peak of my bar is my sole horn. Now, I showed this set of pictures to a group in Arizona last year, and we were working on some horses that had cobblewheel pain. And they brought them in, and it was awesome. We did a couple of dissections, then they all got together and worked on this two horses. And then right before I left, I showed him these pictures. I'm like, I don't know if it's gonna apply to anything, but I love this dissection because it just shows you where that nerve is. And I said, sometimes I'll take a horse that I think really wants a little dental impression material or a little bit of support at the back of the foot, and he hates it. I mean, really hates it. So showed him these pictures, told him that story, and then I had to go leave and pick my husband up at the airport. And the horse had walked in all miserable, and then they worked on him, and before I left, he's walking out, his tail is swinging, he looked like a completely different horse. And then they decided to pour in a pad. And they said it was the most awesome thing ever, because the horse immediately went, ugh. And they all looked at each other and said, if that's not a Paige moment, because they moved on. And they took it out, and the horse went right back. So I've done one nerve dissection like this, so I cannot say that this happens all the time or that nerve is in that spot. I would like to look for more. But it's just something to think about, and it gives you, for me, it's given me confidence to realize sometimes there's just a little something going on in there that I wasn't even on my radar until I did a dissection. So, this is pictures of actually this foot. So I wanted to have them prepped so you didn't have to watch me tear pieces off, because we're really going to concentrate on the back of the foot. So this is I just pulled the hope wall off. I wasn't too careful with the lamina because I knew they'd be trashed by the time I got here anyway. Pulled the sole off, but I wanted you to see what this foot looked like prior to desecrating it. And here is the other foot. You think they're different enough? All right. So, this is what they look like with the puddle. I cut off the edge. That is the end of the talk. So now, with our technical stuff, we're going to try and set up the camera so that I can start taking these 2 feet apart. So it might take a couple of minutes, because we're going to have them projected on the screen.
No,
Does anybody have any questions while we're kind of setting this stuff up? Yes. No, there's it might affect it and make it a little more sticky in that area. That's what I hate about questions like this, because I haven't thought about that, but it might be right that this would end up causing the look pattern, like if you did a section, that you might end up having more coronary band would drop down, the fashion would be bigger. Because I had a horse, one of my own horse ring horses, and there's nothing I can do, that coronary band is like, you can try anything, and I get the spark, but they didn't have side room, but I could get the spark, so I get side room. I just love this. Tom's over here, and I'm going out the back door. Yeah, you didn't look what I have to do. So I had to use my bathtub in the room, and I had to put do not disturb, because I freaked out more than one cleaning lady before. All right. So I could have done this earlier, but I didn't want to smell it for any longer, so sorry. That's good. I had the first trouble. I fly with these things all the time. And you know the poor TSA guys are like, oh, carry them on? I check. And anyway, so yesterday or whatever day I flew in was the first time that I had problems, because I put them in a duffel bag, not a suitcase. And all of a sudden I get the page pass, we need you at the gate. And I had to run back down to the ticket desk. They had to pull my bags, and I had to take them out of the duffel bag and put them in the suitcase. And they were afraid of leakage, which, you know, that's understandable. But I almost missed my flight because I had to go back through TSA, and they're like calling my name again. I'm in trouble everywhere I turn. They did. They got it. Yeah, I'm just unwrapping. We have our little stage prep, so I stay in the seat. Dealing with gorilla tape and gloves is always I didn't actually have to turn it off. The reason I chose these two feet is just one has decent digital cushion, this guy. And you saw in the pictures before. Versus this guy. And I probably, Susan, do you want to come up, do you mind putting on gloves and helping hold?
I do not mind at all. How did you cut that section out?
Well, so what I do is I use a Dremel and I score. And I try to keep my cut consistent, and I found, you know, 2 1/4 inches down puts me near the bottom of my coffin. So I measure from the hairline down. And I want it to be a little above the coffin bone so that I have a clean, see the junction between the sole and the lamina. And, but by keeping it consistent, I can kind of, unless it's a pony or a big draft or something, I find that has helped me understand distal descent and all different types of things.
You guys peel it over.
And then I put it in a vise and I peel the whole sole off. And I also try to keep the whole back of the foot intact so that you can see the details in the sole. So what I wanted to show right here, I think if you'll hold this guy up so I can turn it out. Ken, oh, I love that I picked a black foot. I'm gonna pull out my phone real quick and see if we hold a light there, it really helps. Everybody has a phone, but mine does. Do you have a light?
I do.
You do? Awesome. She's got a flashlight, she's passing on. This is not my favorite way to do the dissections again. I know I said that. Okay. Is that better? No? What is fascinating is that with the whole confirmation of this, look how much this pastern has dropped. You can't even get this guy hardly stand up. Give me a minute to warm up. I'm going to also. Is it back?
Yeah.
Awesome. Okay. So looking at how little volume there is, this guy has little to no digital cushion. So when I pinch like this, look at how little volume there is. I brought this so that we could actually see. Not that this is a real measurement, but comparing. Is that showing?
Yeah.
Okay. Versus this guy.
Do you think there's a correlation with the pastern angle? Maybe it has to have that slippier pastern to absorb the shock.
Yeah. Chicken and egg, though.
Yeah.
Which one causes which?
Right.
Okay, now let's look at this. If you sit these two side by side, look at the difference. I'm going to cut off the periopal of this wall right here so you can see. Is this wrinkle in the way?
No.
Okay. So this guy is down. Look at how low that heel is. There is just nothing we can do about that. And another thing, I can keep these in a Ziploc bag and I can have these at the booth. And if you're brave and want to put on gloves, you can come and actually feel.
Can you tip that towards the camera?
Is it towards the camera
heel,
now?
No, the heel, while you're holding it, just turn it
like
towards the camera.
Problem is, I can't.
The camera's to your, there, yeah.
Okay.
Exactly.
Here?
Yeah. Thank you. Okay, now we can really see the difference from back here.
Okay, you guys are going to have to coach me because I can't look over my shoulder.
Okay.
And
could
see.
You hold one arm up and the other leg?
All right. But isn't it fascinating to see the difference that you're truly swimming upstream trying to fix this foot? But I worry, and we've all tried it before, wedging this mm-hmm. foot. And it ends up just collapsing more.
Yeah.
So I don't know what to tell you to do. Isn't that terrible? One of the saving graces on this particular foot, though, is he actually has more bulk in his frog. So this frog spine is wide, and there's a little bit of a plug here. That is probably the only thing keeping this guy from completely collapsing. So this is like his dental impression material that he's filled in with. If he loses, if the integrity of the frog, I mean, it's not a lovely frog, but I would be reluctant to trim this one up too much because this is the only thing it's filling in for missing digital cushion. So it's like built in something.
Do you think that part afterwards, like maybe it's almost like callus?
Not really, because I see that on healthy feet too. But this is what I coach owners on, that your nutrition and your hygiene is how you personally can help your horse. I can't do that. This is a daily thing. So when I'm able to show people into sections, because I do a lot of these for owners too, I'm like, this is your responsibility. This is not ours.
Yeah.
And so that helps if they've got a horse that's struggling with. This guy has a pretty good, his is narrow, and his heels are contracted or whatever. Anyway, he's kind of narrow in the heels, but he still has a fair amount of volume in here. But look at the difference in, is that lined up with the camera enough to see the difference in height? Mm-hmm. It's sort of like that high-low picture that I sent. Is that better? If I show that. All right. If I lay this in here at the angle of the heel, look at how shallow that angle is. Versus this. Is my hand in the way or is that okay? So again, that whole shape of the lateral cartilage is completely different from this foot. See that angle? It's steeper. And the distance is narrower here. The angle is more shallow here. And we're starting to get an extension. This is sort of like a the bra in Like a Virgin, Madonna's Like a Virgin. Anybody remember that? Yes. This side looks even more collapsed. But again, if you palpate this is cartilage. This is like a nerve. So a lot of times, I would try and trim until I straightened my heel to it. But what's growing those tubules is okay, so there's no amount of trimming that. I think that when I started thinking about how I'm loading my lateral cartilages is when I started affecting that change.
Don't you find that these horses that are high-low and different like that are different from their shoulder down?
Yes, but this is two different horses.
Oh, but I mean, yeah. Just go with one.
Right. But, yeah, a lot of times you're dealing with so many body issues. So, what do I do next? And what can y'all see? I had, can you see okay there? I'm going to go ahead and, like in some of the other pictures, I'm going to go ahead and peel off the skin here. If there's any way you want me to stand these feet up or do anything different, please tell me. Actually, I can't use your help. Can you stabilize this so that it doesn't wiggle? The lighting is so bad, even I can't hardly see. But as you get around to the back, there's very little cushion. It's almost like this periopal is attached straight to the lateral cartilage. So again, that's why I was wondering, is if there's pressure here, is it creating a pressure in the skin and everything to put pressure on that lateral cartilage? Cool lateral cartilage.
You talked about wedge pads, wedge shoes. How do you feel about like a frog support?
You know, the beauty of having, being able to work in a group like this, and then, and work, you know, I know a lot of good barefoot trimmers, and then work, you know, just working with a lot of different farriers who have different training and all, I've found that almost all of these things work sometimes. So I can't say that that's good or bad. It's almost like every time you work on a horse like this, we're doing an experiment. And that's where even seeing that issue with the nerve was like, we really don't know what we're dealing with a lot of times. And it showed me how, you know, we just have to start somewhere on a foot. And with what we've had the most luck with. So I don't have a real opinion on that. But I've seen some horses really like it and seem to respond well. Now, I think there's also different what's responding well. You know, Pat was talking about, you know, you have a big race coming up and you're just gonna do whatever you're gonna do to get that horse able to get through the race. Well, sometimes that's not the goal. Sometimes you really want the horse long term to be better. So it's kind of hard to judge what is an improvement. You know, are you getting an, am I rambling too much? Is that answering your question at all?
So the answer is it good or bad? Yes.
If it works, it's good.
The horse usually does.
Well, most of you have diminishing mass of digital cushion. Do you feel more adhesions or?
Like this one feels dry. Okay. You know how in Arabians, if they have that really, they call it a dry face, where you can see every vein and just the detail? I kind of think of that with these. Where it's like, there's no there's just nothing there. It's like, it's dry. And like, I feel like I'm kind of pulling this off of leather. I find that they dry out, whereas horses with more, like this one smells more. It has more hydration to it. So, yeah, maybe.
So you're noticing that consistently versus the high-low, the low feet kind of have that drier, less?
Well, it's not even high-low, it's just the feet that are crappy, you know, low and no digital, no real volume of digital cushion and stuff.
Do you see less robust vasculature in a foot like that?
You know, this is where it's frustrating because I'm not really doing science. I'm just literally cutting these things open, and that's part of the reason I like doing so much of the photography, because I feel like I can share the images with other people who have lots of experience, and they can help answer some of those questions. Because with the vasculature, it's, you know, sometimes like this has been boiled and it's just not the same consistency.
You have to use a venogram.
Yeah. And you know, I'm kind of doing this out of my own pocket. So there's so many of these. No, but it's interesting because there's so many questions that we all have. So if you look at this, I'm almost to the peak of the lateral cartilage. I just came a little bit before. But look at how flexible and how little cushion there is. I mean, there is none. This is my deep digital flexor tendon. It almost, you can feel this joint underneath the deep digital. I can palpate and almost feel where P1 and P2 come in. Is that clear?
Yes.
Is that real pixelated? Do we need to refocus?
It's a little fuzzy.
It's a little fuzzy.
Did you just step out?
Maybe back away from the camera.
Yeah, move it away from the camera a little bit.
He's right.
Move to your left.
To my left.
My left.
Your left.
Is that better?
Yeah.
Now, Paige, do you feel like that elasticity is from being so squished over time?
I just don't know. And that's where, again, I was really interested to hear what Pat said, where he's working on 2 to 5 year olds, and he doesn't find it to be this extreme. So now, I'm going to pull this one apart, and it's completely different. I think I'm okay at the moment, because it had more room to work. But look, you probably can see, just the moisture. I mean, the fascia is still flexible and elastic. Sometimes you'll get damage from the freezer and all too. So I can't make too many assumptions. But I find that a lot of times I would go pick up legs and I would know how long they had been dead. And I would know that I put them in the freezer the same day. And I treated the feet the same way, and that they would still look vastly different. Got to be a difference in tissue.
Have you assessed the damages in the bone when comparing a right foot to the other?
I've started doing that, and I have a new book that I actually had a horse with high-low, and I did some of the pictures you saw were from his dissection, and what was cool about it is I even then boiled out the bones, and it was very fascinating to see the difference in the two. And I'm starting to get, before I moved from Virginia to Arizona, I had 3 other sets of high-low that I really looked forward to doing that. And when you're moving and it's 100 degrees, all of a sudden bringing dead parts across the country just didn't sound that appealing, so they got chopped. But I'm hoping to collect more specimens like that so I can answer more of those questions. But I do think there's differences. One of the biggest differences was that the foot, the volume of the foot seemed to be the same. It was like that box thing where it's like, you know, one of them, everything was compacted up underneath his pastern, and the other one it kind of squirted out. So it was cool to cut out the digital cushion and feel it in my hands and go, these guys are similar. More similar than dissimilar, even though the flat foot looked like it didn't have as much digital cushion.
So in comparing the bones, you feel like the lower angle foot would have a little more damage than the upright foot?
More changes.
Itself.
It had more remodeling.
It had more remodeling.
I can show you those pictures if you come by the booth, and it was really cool.
Do you get backstories on the feet that you dissect?
Some, like Angel.
Well, yeah. Like, do you find more front feet issues with jumpers with their digital cushion getting flattened versus trainers that have hind end issues with their digital cushions?
Well, you know where I came from, and there weren't a whole lot of trainers in Middleburg, Virginia. I primarily had fox hunters. Look at the difference in the color of the tissue and just everything about it. Look at the hydration, just the dryness.
Great, can you put it closer to the lens because it washes out so far away? Maybe not.
Are these both from the same, like, have they been dead the same amount of time?
I don't really know.
Okay.
I had to drive 6 hours total to go get these things because I don't have a good source in Tucson yet. I didn't realize it's cheaper for people to just bury their horses than it is to send them to the rendering plant. So I'm kind of finding that they're willing to give them to me, the rendering plant. I just don't have access to them because they're usually not going to the rendering plant. Can you guys see the difference in this? Thickness, huge difference in thickness of the lateral cartilage. I don't know that I can have, because I'm having to do it here, it's hard. And if you want to go sit down, I think that I have to do one at a time.
Okay.
So you can see. Again, look at how thin that cartilage is versus this one. Is that showing?
Yeah.
The other thing is this guy had a little bit of a sheer heel. But look at how the cartilage, the height of the cartilage, this one's more jammed up than that one. So the whole back of his foot is torn. And that's one of those things that's easier to show you if you can put your hands on it. But can you see the movement, how the side of the deep digital seems to be grinding on the lateral cartilage here? Oh no. So if I put my finger here and move this, I can feel my deep digital, and I'll extract that out more in a minute. And that peak of the lateral cartilage, this is where my nerve would be. That's pretty loose. On this side, I can barely get my finger in there.
And you don't weigh 1,200 pounds either.
No way.
Pushing down on that leg.
And I'm not jumping or...
Yeah. But even just standing, a horse standing, shifting his weight on is not nearly what you're pressing. I mean, you're
exactly
not really pressing as much as that.
So let me see. Was moving it interesting?
Yes, very.
Okay. Can you see this one, or does this pastern get in the way? I can only move it a little bit. Does that help?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. See it? Completely different.
So that meteor one still seems to get a lot more.
Could be the way I'm holding it. Because I can't put it on the ground. But let me see if I... But But this one's so soft, I don't think that nerve would get pinched. Because that cartilage is just going to bounce out of the way. And what I found, I didn't work on that many navicular type horses, because where I was in Northern Virginia, it was mainly warm bloods and thoroughbreds. I didn't even have that many boxy footed horses. I really didn't ever see Arabs. I didn't see quarter horses. But when I started trimming, I was in North Carolina, and there was mainly Arabs and quarter horses. So I wonder if just the lateral cartilages were thinner on a lot of horses I was working on, and that this thicker, boxier foot is the one that's going to have more irritation to that nerve. All right. What's next? This is what I like throwing pieces out, and you guys look at this while I do the next thing instead of y'all just having to sit there and watch me cut stuff. Would everybody like that? I mean, they're kind of smelly, but if people want to actually hold these soles and look at them, or we can do it at the end, because this is lunchtime. What do y'all want? I'm happy to pass them around.
Let's do it after, right? Yeah. Then people can glove up and stuff.
What time is it getting to be?
11:30.
Oh, okay. So now what I'm going to do, I might need you again, Stephen. Because, is this pretty focused right there?
Yes.
I'm wondering if we can do away with the light now that the black is off the pastern of this flat foot. And see, you guys get to vote. Is that image better?
Oh,
much better?
No.
Is that better? There. That's better. Me.
That's better.
Okay. So now what I'm going to do is, actually, you know the end of my coffin bow? I have found, unless the Palmer process has started growing back or you've got some remodeling going on, I've found that true heel to be kind of in the middle of my central sole.
Can you show that to the camera? Oh, people...
I'm showing you guys.
I know, but
I have to show.
We only get to see it instead of everybody.
So here's that true heel I talked about, right here and right there. And when I come in and take my knife, I usually don't hit bone. I did on this more upright foot, but I'm going to cut off all the back of the foot. I'm going to try and preserve it so that you have some, you can see how much of the bone is sticking out the back. I wish I had x-rays on these guys, but I had to spend a whole day going to get them, so I wasn't able to stop by the vet and get x-rays. He might have some side wound. Susan, since I have to do it for the camera, I'll be careful. You're just getting your exercise for the day. Okay. If you want to see from the camera.
Can I talk to you while you're...
Absolutely.
Okay, so I've had times where I've trimmed a horse the way I like it and really think that there's too much heel, but I don't want to change the foot. So I've dropped the heel from right around the bars back, so the foot is no longer flat on the bottom. Mm-hmm. And I've really had, like you say, it doesn't work for every horse, but I've had a lot of success doing that. Have you ever done that?
Yes. Same type of thing, it's an experiment. And then sometimes if I really don't know if that's what I should be doing, I really question it. And, you know, as a horse that has kind of similar issues in both feet, I will actually do it to one. See which he likes better. That especially works well with my own.
Oh yeah, especially for a sheer too.
Yeah. But you know, sometimes if you just want to try to experiment, but I've had that work.
I also do that almost every time I put a wedge pad on. I found very a lot of success with that. The wedge pad doesn't create as much pressure.
What I'm trying to do is make it so you can see how much bone is at the end here, but I might have to just go in and cut it off because that's one of those things that's easier when we can, you can be looking at other stuff instead of watching me wrestling again. What's going on here? But I wanted to show you how cool it was. What I'm trying to do is cut off the digital cushion back to the deep digital flexor tendon. Great picture of my arm, right?
Oh, fantastic. Nice elbow.
Well, I'm not twisting to try and show it on the camera. No, it's so funny. I do a lot of whole horse dissections with a veterinary friend of mine. We do them for other professionals.
Yeah.
And she always used to start out with her scalpels and knee crossing knives. And she was always like, oh, you know, you need to be using this. And it's like, after about 3 hours, this nice big handle is so much easier on your hand. The other, and you can change your blade out really quickly. So I found the box cutter, and now she always uses the box cutter too. So she started slumming it for me. Just a little bit more.
Paige, do you notice a difference in the texture of that digital cushion before you pull it out on a high foot or a low foot? The difference in that bridging of that fibrous tissue?
It depends on how I cut it. You can really see the difference. Hold on. This has got to be a lot of fun to watch.
When you use a vise at home, or?
Yes, I have a vise.
Yeah.
I also usually sit down and have it in my lap so I can kind of dress a little different.
Challenging you.
Yeah, so gosh, I don't know. The clarity is there to be able to, you can see some of those little ligaments here. If I run my fingers on it, you can almost hear where they're attaching from one side to the other. But this guy doesn't have as much digital cushion as you would have thought. But I'll pull the other one, and you'll be able to see the resistance to the twisting that this one has versus this one. It'll be like, will have no integrity. So while I wrestle, do you want to come up and hold this a second? And you can play Vanna White for a minute if you like. And hold this in front of the camera. You can look over your shoulder while I take the digital cushion off of this one. So you can show people how far in just taking off the digital cushion. I'm not to the navicular bone yet. Actually, I do want to show one thing because this is going great on this one. Hold on. I've gone past my true heel. This is a true heel on this guy. But I'm all the way up here. Voila. No bone. That's what it's normally like. That's why I think this guy has some issues with side bone and palmar processes have extended. Are you surprised at how much? I'm not hitting any bone.
Oh, thank you.
That's more normal.
So when you say the true heel, you mean the true heel of the bone?
True heel of my corium, so the end of my sole corium and the lamina, where they join each other. So if you're looking here, see I have sole, you can see the lamina there,
right,
and lamina here. I'm calling that area the true heel.
Could you show us that on the bottom?
On the bottom of the hoof, it's kind of the seat of corn. But makes sense because the lamina are going to grow your wall and the sole corium is going to grow your sole. So it's kind of the internal seat of corn. Of course, this is going to be a little further, there's a little more bulk because this is added. So you've got a teeny tiny cartilage covered in these coriums, and then this guy's wrapping around that, so it's a little further back.
So pretty much what you're saying is that it's the peel right before when it turns into lamina.
That's what I'm calling the true heel. So you've gone from the papilla of the sole to the lamina. Do you want to put some gloves on and feel the difference and show them?
Yeah.